Welcome back on Tabletop. I'm here with my friend Rufus, and we're going to take a look at what has been one of our very highly requested items, some quick playthroughs of Firelock Games, new Blood and Valor World War I system. So they're taking their basic system from Blood and Plunder, which has, of course, been very successful, and we're trying to expand it now into some new periods. We're taking a look at the trenches of World War I. So I've decided to stick with the Germans because I had some pretty good luck yesterday shooting the hell out of some British at Freeman's Farm. I'm going to see if that luck holds for me. So I'm here with the Imperial Germans, and Rufus was taking me through some list construction.
Yeah, we'll just jump right into it. So basically, it is a it is in the Blood and Plunder system. If you play Blood and Plunder, you'll recognize some of the core mechanics. But I think of it more of as a cousin. It's not an identical game. You know, there are nuances and differences which people will see as they play. Basically, we'll go over the quick army setup. You have a core unit of riflemen, command team. Unlike Blood and Plunder, there's an actual team of commanders, and you have some stormtroopers. This is a smaller force. This is a demo force. This table is slightly smaller. It's a 2x2. You normally play on a 3x3. But, you know, we're trying to teach people and show people the game, so we want them to get into contact as quick as possible. One of the big differences, the big interesting things of this game is you have army initiative, and the way you decide your army initiative is how your force is built. Your commander will give you 2 initiative points. Each core unit will give you 3. Each support will give you 1. So as you see here, we have 2, 5, 8, 9, and this corresponds with the how much initiative you have. Okay. As obviously, if you have a bigger force, you'd have more initiative, or the way you build your force can alter that. What the initiative does is determines who goes first and who goes second in the game. Each player has a set of numbers. I could show them to you, but it's 0 through 6. So turn number 1, we're gonna figure out who goes first. So I'm just gonna pick a random one. Why not? So say the British player puts that one down, and the German player puts this one down. Both players reveal. German has 4, British has 2. German player's gonna go first. This is reduced by 4 to 5. And conversely, this one's reduced to 7. That being said, you would go with activate one of your units. Activate one of his units on the other side.
So is this almost like expendable initiative? This is a certain number of points I get to spend in
right,
a given...
for a whole turn. And what a turn is once everybody's gone. A round is 1 and 1, 1 and 1, back and forth. Whole turn, everybody's gone. At the end of a whole turn, this resets back up to 9.
So you're able to, like, decide as a commander what part of the turn sequence is most important to you.
Of course, like, you need to go first. You want to go second and be reactionary. As you see,
I've been wargaming for 35 years. I've never seen that before. That's actually pretty awesome.
Thanks. The interesting thing now, so now we're into, say this turn's over, these go back into the hands or back into each player. Now, this player has 7. He knows if he bids 6, he's going to go first because you only have 5 left. So it's the thing I like about it, it's not only you're playing the game, you're also playing the opponent. If you know your buddy really well that you're playing against, you can bluff him into burning a lot of his initiative early in the turn, and now you're in control for the rest of the turn. If you ever get it to 0, and you start activating units with 0 initiative, instead of having 2 actions, they'll only have 1. It explains command and control. So your command and control is basically falling apart because you've gotten rid of all your initiative actions, and your units are becoming less effective as they move.
So it doesn't like slam the game to a halt, slam your turn to a halt, but it does definitely slow it down.
Yes. Normally for turn 1 in most games you're maneuvering. So a lot of times you want to see what your opponent's doing. Turn 2 and turn 3, now it's I really want to go first. Because whoever goes first is going to pull that assault off or going to get those shots off. I had this scenario here, which is the basic everybody does, is the kill scenario. You know, we're trying to kill each other. There are 9 other scenarios in the game. They're all objective-based scenarios, forcing people to maneuver. I don't want to turn this game into everybody sitting in the trenches just shooting away at each other. That's not what this game is. It's a trench raiding. It's a get out there and do stuff. But that being said, you don't have to play in trenches. Most of the games or most of the theaters represented are not in trenches. You can play in Africa. You can play in the Near East. You can play in Gallipoli. You can play 1914. Pre-trench warfare.
That was for you, Tauros.
Yes. So you could set up and have a bunch of cavalry running around on the board. obviously they're not going to have grenades and gas because that's later. There is historical constraints to what you can do, but it's not a only in the trenches, a slugfest. That's not the concept. I wanted to get the flavor of World War I, allow players to enjoy and have a good game, but not sit there for 3 hours bombarding each other with not a lot of results. That's unfortunately, you know, those big battles happen like that, but that doesn't game, that's not very fun to play those kind of games.
A dirty secret of historical wargaming: not every historical battle makes for a good war game.
That's true, absolutely. Rock's Drift to the Zulus. You know. So one other thing that's a major difference between us, this game, and Blood and Plunder. As you know, Blood and Plunder, you have a lot of variations in skill levels. A German rifleman and a British rifleman are basically, stat lines-wise, very similar, almost identical. They have basically the same equipment, same level of training. There are special rules, which I won't get into, but there are special rules for every faction that give slightly different a feel to them. Okay, a good example for the Germans, is called Blutenstahl, which is blood and steel. So in close combat, they can reroll saves. They're not game breakers, but they're flavor changers. So it makes you feel a little different.
This gives like a little bit of a stormtrooper a flavor.
Stormtroopers have special abilities. They're probably one of the most expensive units in the game, but they should be. They're highly trained to raid trenches. As I'm saying with that, each unit when they activate has two actions. Unlike, you know, Blood and Plunder, where you can do three or one or two, or, you know, it varies. So your actions can be move, run, which when you run, you would move 8 inches, you gain a token, which gives you a cover until the next time they activate. So they're harder to hit. Moving, harder to hit. You can shoot, you can aim and shoot, which is pretty nice. So that actually, the way aiming and shooting looks is you want to shoot across the board, you need a 10 to hit. If you aim, you need 9s now. Ranges are unlimited because a bolt action rifle will fire 2,000 yards. You're probably not going to hit anything, but you can shoot across the board.
The range is at least 500 yards, which is well in excess.
So, yes. But obviously, you should play on a board with some terrain, and these guys move, and they move through the terrain, and so it'll be harder to hit these guys. But that being said, you know, why have a limit on the range? I mean, they'll shoot. They'll do it. Another one you can do is take cover, which just gives you a bonus to saving, you know, that makes you harder to hit. Rally. And then there's the commander, which also has two actions, but he has command points he can give out. Better commanders obviously cost more points than, you know, lower level commanders. This is a lieutenant. He can give out that command point to give an extra action. And then there's one interesting thing that I have that's very unique to this is, each commander in the game, once per game, can do a special move called the Grand Maneuver. You activate your command unit, say you're doing the Grand Maneuver, then every unit within his command range, which this one is 8 inches, gets a free 4-inch move. They all can move. So that represents blowing the trench whistle and they're all getting out. The coup de grace, where you want to bring them in. They can't get into combat, but it's a move. And that's outside of all, if they haven't moved yet, doesn't count against them. They can move and do all this neat stuff, which if you take Captain Rommel, not General Rommel, he gets two of those. So there are a lot of historical characters, especially that are very famous in World War II, that were in World War I as lower ranks. So they're in the game.
Just no Austrian Lance Corporals, I hope.
No. But for our English friends, there's J.R.R. Tolkien's in the game.
Hey, there you go.
Kind of an interesting little thing. Basically, I'm giving you most of it. One other thing I want to bring up is a lot of people ask terrain. There are no terrain modifiers. You move through terrain, like you just move. That being said, because these guys are highly trained, the only thing you cannot just willy-nilly move through is barbed wire. So we do have a way, if you cross barbed wire, you make a roll, 5 or better, you're good, no problem. Lower, you would put this token down, hung on the wire. That means you're just stuck like Chuck until the next turn. And if someone, you know, they shoot you. But that being said, once you activate them again, they can just move. I don't want to create it where you keep failing that roll and just stuck there for turn after turn. I don't think that's very realistic and not fun for gameplay.
Barbed wire is a delaying fortification, not really a stopping.
Yes. I pretty much encapsulated almost all the rules that quickly, just to give you an idea. There are more layers to this. There are bombardments. There are gas bombardments. There are heavy machine guns, light machine guns, grenades, rifle grenades. As I said, we have cavalry. We have all kinds of different specialized, more specialized, flavorful units. The French have Singalese. They have Harlem Hellfighters are in the game. Gurkhas are in the game. Arab Irregulars with Lawrence of Arabia are in the game. This Australian Light Horse is available. Ataturk, the Turks. And so there's a lot, you know, I try to put as much flavor and
options. There's a lot of options.
There are 10 forces you can start in the starting book and 10 scenarios in the starting book. Another big question I always get is, what about tanks? Tanks are in the game. Because everybody wants tanks in the game. Because tanks are cool. I understand that. But tanks are very much more in the narrative play. The way I did it is I broke the scenarios down. Five scenarios are truly competitive. Competitive and balanced. If you're going to run a tournament, those are the scenarios you should use. Meaning both players have a 50-50 shot of winning the game. No, there's no crazy variables in there. Then there's five more narrative scenarios. One of them is a disabled tank in the middle of the board. There's rolling involved to have successes or failures. There's more variables. It's more for, hey, you and your buddy meet up and say, hey, let's try this out. Let's see what happens, something crazy. And so that's not really designed for that competitive fair play. It's more designed for having fun and doing crazy stuff. And if you want to play with tanks, there's a scenario where you could build tanks into your force, and you, if you want to bring 100 of them, you can bring 100 of them and roll around on the, well, break down regularly on the board and do that. But I want that option in there for players if they want to get into to use those, you know, stuff. A good example, historically, the Germans only had 20 A7Vs ever.
Definitely an exception to the rule.
So, but they are there. So you can use all the different types of tanks.
Tanks shot at each other in World War I exactly once.
One time.
It was a grand total of four tanks on that
field. Yep. So that's pretty good overview of the game and understand it. And obviously there's more to it. My goal was easy to learn, hard to master. Learn it quick, and then you start realizing, ooh, I should do this, I'll do that. Synergy and stuff, and that makes it for a better, obviously a more enjoyable and better game.
All right, cool. All right, so do we want to start we're go through like one turn here, show people how it works?
Sounds great to me.
All right, good. All right, so if I won initiative, can I say that you're moving first?
Sure, you did win initiative. I pulled randomly, so let's just go with it.
Cool. All right, because we're beginning, I'm going to go and ask you to move first then.
You want me to be the German? I mean the British?
No, I'm playing the Germans.
So you want to move. I'm confused. You're confusing me.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm playing the Germans. I won initiative, and I would choose to go second.
No, you don't choose to go second.
Okay, never mind.
The way you choose to, it's a good point, because that was brought up in playtesting. The way you choose to go second is you've been one.
Oh, you deliberately lose initiative.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Okay, all right,
so
cool.
So you say, I want to go second. So anyway.
All right, so we're over the top.
But you managed to win, so you're stuck.
Okay, cool. So I will go ahead and go first. So what's the movement rate on these guys?
It's you move in 4-inch segments. Okay, and one of the reasons, so say, we'll just show an example. So these guys move 4 inches, okay? And now you have another action. Or you can move 8 inches using both of your actions, and then you'd get a run token to make you harder to hit until the next time they're activated. Well, the reason I have that broken up like that, 4 instead of just moving 8 all the time, is that you can't run across barbed wire. So say if you were here, you move your 4 inches, now you have to test and move your next 4. And you can only charge 4 inches. So you can't charge 8 inches, it's a 4-inch move. So you have to move in danger close and then charge your 4 inches.
Okay, so I go ahead and move my, let me see. Let me try to get to some cover here. So 8 inches?
Anywhere in that building's fine.
That works.
Once again, there's no rough ground rules, so you just move in there.
Yeah, I was going to ask if there was any kind of penalty, but you already answered that question for coming out of the
obviously
trench.
You can't run off a cliff, so you should decide that before the game starts.
Oh, no!
Yeah,
there he goes.
You know, within reason. Which may come in Gallipoli. I guess conceivably if you did a Gallipoli table, that could show up. No, it's just one unit.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry about
that. So then they're done. You ran.
Yep.
That token shows they finished. And then we then remember, you want initiative for this round, so then a British unit would go, which I'll just move it. I'm gonna bring my crazy Scotsman. They're just gonna run right up the middle. They are one of the close assault units. Please stand up. Thank you very much. Very simple. They run. Yep. Yeah. Let's just go. Oh, these are stormtroopers.
Yeah. So I'm saying I'm gonna have to get some stormtroopers that way to fight your own.
So they've done their run. Now we would bid again.
Oh, I got
you. Yep. And remember, you have your tokens here. It's just gonna be kind of hard to do. Hold a microphone. But I guess you can do it. This is my son. Actually, this is my son. The game, this was actually his concept. We were floating in the pool one day, and he said, "Hey, I got a cool idea for a game." And I said, "That really is a cool idea for a game." And there that's how it's got to start somewhere. So that was the start.
Okay, so I have.
So we flip?
Yep.
There we go. So we both got a two. So what does that mean? When we do get a tie, it's a roll-off. But there are commanders in the game that can give you a plus one or plus two to that roll off. So that might be important to you as you play or not. So we just roll off. I got a six.
I got a five, so
I
win.
I win an issue. This goes down from 7 to 5. So I went down. And now one of my units activate. Which I'm gonna try, just so we can see it, I'm gonna shoot you.
Okay.
Now, you cannot shoot through your own units. That is one rule. Obviously, I wouldn't want one of my guys shooting through me. Elevation, though, you can shoot over guys.
I moved one of my stormtroopers by mistake.
No, kill you for you got him.
Okay.
You did it right. They just have one of them has a camo helmet. So the way shooting works, which we'll go over, I'm shooting this unit at that unit. If everybody in my unit can see at least one guy in your unit, I can do the shot. No problem. So the range bands work. Everybody starts at a basic 6 to hit. And then it progresses up from there as it gets harder. From 0 to 6 inches adds nothing to that base number. 6 to 12 adds 1. 12 to 18 adds 2. Anything over 18 adds 3. So your range bands are pretty simple. It's just 1, 2, or 3. And then anything over that, you're beyond it. I made this table slightly wider than 18. So I know I'm over 18. So I'm over 18, so I'm a 6 plus 3 makes it 9. Then I have intervening cover. These count, so it goes to 10. But I'm aiming, goes back to 9. See how the aiming mechanic works? So I would roll 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 dice. And I'm looking for 9. It's not the best shot, but I could actually do something, which, well, of course I roll pretty good. So I have 2 hits. Now you've been hit twice. Your basic save is a 6, but because you are in hard cover, it drops to a 5. So 2 dice, 5 or better to save your Germans.
We must save now from the British. No, said one.
Now, this brings up one other mechanic of the game. If you decide to re-roll this, which I'm not saying you should, you can re-roll them. Each player gets 3 bullets. It's called bite the bullet. But it's an all or nothing roll. So if you get greedy, re-roll it and fail both, you fail both. So you could say, I want to use the bullet, bite the bullet, re-roll, and then go from there. Well, when I first started playing, I was using real bullets. So they were rolling around. And I said, probably letting them roll around my house is probably not a good idea. So I would not do that. That doesn't make a lot of sense. So one guy dies. And then we go to now you have to take a resolve because it simulates them getting shot, you know, their ability to stay in the game. One resolve for the hit, very similar to Blood and Plunder, which I like the resolve system, fatigue system, and one resolve for the dead, for the soldier that got killed. But big difference, their normal resolve is a 6, but because they're within line of sight and range, they got a seam of their commander, it drops to 5.
Okay, so 2 out of 5. Kill one wasn't any more high difficulty or anything?
No.
Okay, so two chances above a 5. One miss, one succeed.
So you take 1 fatigue. All right. This is working good because everything is happening that we should see. So the unit now has 1 fatigue dice.
Okay.
If you notice, if it gets to 2 fatigue, there's a minus 1 next to it. So the minus one, what that does is if you activate a unit with two fatigue and the minus one modifier, it'll only have one action.
Okay.
And that being said, if you activate a unit with minus one action with zero, it'll have this many, zero actions. So it's beholden upon the player to monitor, you know, to pay attention to that. You can take command, you can give it command points and stuff like that, and you know, tell it to do stuff from your commander, but the unit itself has no actions. It can always rally, though.
It requires direct leadership from
right. It can always rally. If you have no actions at all, you can always do the rally action, but that's basically what you're limited to.
Okay.
So I've taken my shot, no reload markers in this one, so, and now one of your units goes.
Okay, so 8 inches. Let me get my stormtroopers up there, see what they can do. Stormtrooper forwards. All right, number eight. Sorry, you said 2 4s become 8. All right.
Yep.
So I'm going to try to, I'm
James.
Sorry. Yep.
4 plus 4 is 8.
Oh, oh, thanks. Okay, I got it. All right.
Oh, well, I know most of us have issues with simple math when you play these games. It happens to me, too.
4 plus 4, you will say, what, did I say something different?
No.
Okay.
I can't add 5 plus 2 when I play these games. I don't know what happens in my head. So
well, on day 4 of the con, God knows what I'm going to say.
Yeah, right, no.
Especially on
camera. I can't believe I can still talk. So you ran, and you
yep.
have the cover.
Cool.
So now we would bid again. So you have 5 left, correct?
Yep.
I have 5. You can always ask your opponent what he has left. This is not a secret that, you know, I can find out. So now I know we're basically whoever goes. So we don't know. Okay, go ahead and flip yours. I have a 3, 5. So you're going first. I go down to 3. And you go down to 0.
That's 10. That's not the same as a 0.
Oh, yeah. See, simple math. There it came up.
Hey!
That's why I guess we've hit the point you're smarter than me. Oh, no. The one fatigue on them doesn't affect them at all. They can move normally. So.
Right. I'm just wondering if I should move my commanders up first in case these guys take more fire. Because are these guys still in line of sight? For the commander's bonus? Okay.
That brought up a good point.
Line of sight. It's true line of sight. I like games where the player has to get down, get a model's eye view. If you could see the torso and the head of your target, you're fine. Seeing his finger doesn't count, you know, within reason. But torso and heads, you're fine. You can see him, and you can shoot at him or command him or whatever.
I'm just trying to get a little aggressive. Fatigue desk goes with them.
Run.
Awesome.
And
thank you.
Activation token. So we remember.
Okay.
So now I'm.
It'll come to me. All right, here, I'm going to get tricky now. You're in trouble. First thing I'm going to do is activate my commander. Commander is going to run up in this hole. Yep, so he's going to hang out. He's actually activated. Now he has a command point to give out. And he also has the grand maneuver. I'm going to use the grand maneuver right now. So every unit within his command range, which is basically all my units, are going to get a free 4-inch move. With the grand maneuver, you can actually move a unit 16 inches in a turn. One unit. He'll probably get annihilated because he'll be on the wrong side of the board, but you can do it. So they haven't actually activated yet. They've moved, but they haven't activated. So these guys are going to come up. Okay, my Scots are going to come up here, get these sticks out of the way. They're more decorative than anything. Now, here's a good example. They do not lose this, because they have not actually activated. This is out of turn.
This is all totally and he, based on the command.
Right, and he gets the grand maneuver himself because he's leading from the front or leading his troops. Now I have one command point left. That command point I'm going to give to the Scots and tell them to charge those guys. So this will probably not work because there's a lot of rolls I got to do here to pull this off, but we'll show how it works. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to try to cross this wire. So if I fail this, they're stuck and my charges just fail. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do is try to cross this wire, which I do. Okay. So now.
I think that was an important roll because if he gets hung up in that wire, next turn, triple crossfire.
Remember, I can always use bite the bullet too to re-roll all rolls. Every roll, it doesn't matter. You can re-roll it, re-roll it, reload, but he got one. So I've successfully said I'm going to cross the wire. I could ask you, would you like to defensive fire?
and I can do that even though I've already activated.
Yes.
Okay.
But you will gain a fatigue to do it. You want a defensive fire.
Yeah. I'm just. Do you have to declare which unit you're charging?
Oh, I'm charging them.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, yeah, you're correct.
I just want to make sure it wasn't these guys.
No.
All right, in that case, I will take the fatigue to do counterfire.
So now we look. See, this is why it's important. I'm going to get cover starting this charge. If I was charging you from another angle in the open, I wouldn't. So you could get some benefit out of this.
You have to pick your route of advance.
Okay, so you're all within. They all can see somebody, so they're fine. They're within six, so it's six is the base. No range modifiers. Seven for the wire, and then here's the other one. Eight for the run. So you hit me on eights, and I believe you have six guys in there.
Three, four, five, six. Okay. Englishman, ze kommen. And three? I have to get above a six?
Eight.
Above an eight. Okay,
remember,
yeah, two.
Six is base.
That's right, that's
plus
right.
One, plus one. So you got two?
Two, yep.
So that means this charge is going to go off, because if I somehow got the three fatigue here, well, no, I could fail this conceivably. If I get the three fatigue, I'll be shaken and fall back. That's how you can actually stop a charge. Charging a fresh unit is not the best move in the world, but you could get lucky. These guys save on sixes. I don't get hard cover, soft cover. So I failed them both. Guess what? That's as they refer to bullet time, and I'm doing that one again. And I still fail them both. This has gone horribly wrong, so this might not work. Now I have three resolve tests. One for each dead guy, one for the actual hit. My commander's right here. They can see him. Their base resolve is five, it goes to four. They are close combat, they want to get some. They want to get in there. So I take one fatigue, that's fine. This is still gonna go off. So, first thing, I have this cool stuff called grenades. Yeah. Grenades have a 4-inch range. I'm gonna throw some grenades at you. I normally could throw four grenades, but because I only have two guys left, I can only throw two grenades. It progresses down as you get smaller units. I'm looking for sevens for these. That's a base number, it's always sevens. I got one grenade hit. Your save, instead of having a cover save at all, is just nine or better.
Nine or better.
It's basically that grenade has landed amongst your troops and it's exploded.
Okay, so
you
I have
one save, nine or better.
Okay. I don't have to say ones for each guy.
No, just
it's an area effect weapon?
No.
Okay.
It's not that devastating. Of course he makes it.
Yeah.
Of course.
Caught it and threw it back at you.
So
I think you lost some.
Now I can shoot the guns. It's all simultaneous. So chucking grenades, throwing guns. Now I'm going to charge. Oh, no, you're right. Well, we're going to show how it goes. Good point. So I'm going to shoot the guns. I'm not going to shoot the guns. Forget it. You're right. I forgot I charged. Yeah, why you whisper that to me? Sorry. Ignore the grenades, but we saw how they worked, and you survived. So I did charge. That's it. Kai brought up a good point.
So my one lucky roll didn't count.
Just yes.
That's uncounted.
Yeah, yes. Kai brought up a good point, though. Say if I had activated these guys within 4 inches, I could have shot and charged because I have two actions.
Gotcha.
But you can't shoot twice or close combat twice. So if
you can have two actions, you just can't take the same action twice except one.
Right, and that would pull off the perfect combo. So anyway, so I did charge. When I charge, I lose these. You lose these run tokens.
Oh, yeah, because you're not moving anymore. Right?
Yeah, and your running has no effect on close combat because you're right next to me. The Scots have a special rule called blood-curdling charge. When they charge, it gets one easier to hit. So normally, they hit on a six, it goes to fives. And all close combat guys have close combat specialists, so I can re-roll fails.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm looking for fives, re-rolling fails. So the one is a fail. So I get two hits on you. Saves on these are sevens or better. Close combat saves are worse. They're not as good as...
Yeah. It's a bayonet in the belly. One.
One, so you lose a guy.
And is that going to increase fatigue?
You got to roll for it.
Oh.
You got one hit and one dead guy. So you're rolling. Are you within eight of this guy? See, that guy you picked out might have kept you within eight.
Okay, so I will pluck this dude out. Get game with him for a second.
You look like you're just out. I don't know.
Okay.
I can't tell.
Yeah, I'd say I am.
So you save on sixes. Your resolve tests are on sixes.
One makes
so
a
you
success.
Pick up a fatigue.
Sweet.
So that being said, now, unlike a lot of other games, we don't fight this out to the bitter end. Now we're locked in.
Okay.
It's a good example of they've activated, I've activated. If you have another unit, you could actually feed them into this close combat that still hasn't activated. But next turn, who goes first? Whoever goes first here is probably going to finish this off. So it becomes, that's where that, where it starts. You start, I really want to go first. Or go first with these guys and bringing them in and finish my guys before they even harm your guys. And I think we can call it, I mean, we've seen pretty much most of the game. Although I kind of messed up the grenades, but whatever, we got to see how they work. So that's been in a nutshell. I mean, we've basically played a quick turn and seen almost every aspect of what can go on in the game.
Commander just needs to pull his finger out there and actually war us this way.
Oh, hey, I got a question. I got a question for all gamers out there. Why does every company make their commander models like this? This is always, it's just the pointy dude. And who would you shoot at if you were, on the? I would shoot at the guy pointing immediately, pointing at that guy. I bet you in real life they don't do a lot of that pointing, so.
All right, well, hey, thanks very much for taking me through that. This definitely seems like it plays very smooth. You've got all the kinks worked out. It definitely has that close assault feel. Rush up, take your opportunity fire or your reactor fire. You know, different games use different terms. Somebody chucks in some grenades, and then it comes down to E-tools and bayonets. Yeah, it's definitely got that feel to it. I like how barbed wire slows down, but doesn't actually stop. It doesn't sound terribly ferocious, except, you know, in World War I, there's usually a couple Maxims, or World War I, there's a couple Maxims over here. You don't want to get slowed down in no man's land. Yeah, I think it's again, I've only played one turn, but yeah, I definitely like where, definitely like what I see so far.
Yeah, and we are in the very final stages of playtesting. Basically, this was our last kind of run through. When we get back from Historicon, the next step is, you know, we're moving along in the process, and we should be out with the book before the end of the year, if not earlier, hopefully November, possibly right around that area. So we're close, and yeah, we're looking forward to it. One other thing I want to say is, remember, this is just a, you know, beat into each other kind of game. It's not a, when you add the objectives in it, it adds a whole another dynamic to how you're playing. You know, it makes the, it just takes a whole another layer, so it makes it really more interesting.
I really like this initiative system, seriously. Where you can kind of pick what phase of the turn is most important to you and when. A lot of times when I'm learning a new game, the first thing I'll ask is, okay, how does initiative work? And is going first always a good thing? Because there's a lot of games where going first is the last thing you want to do. But this game actually lets you choose, and it's not random. So, yeah, this part I really like.
That was a big thing I wanted to do, is create a way where the players can have some control over initiative. Within reason, you know, but to have something, not just a random, like you said, random, like, or I roll good, now I get to go, maybe I don't want to go, and, you know, those kind of things.
All right, cool. So, cool. Thanks very much, sir. I appreciate it.
Good job.
All right, guys, that's going to go ahead and close us out. We hope you enjoyed this quick playthrough, like a sample, you know, a playthrough here of Blood and Valor. Thanks very much, Rufus. Thanks very much for helping us out with our audio. Hope you guys liked it. Hope you guys check this game out when it comes out. We're going to go ahead and sign off for now. Keep commenting below and checking out our coverage for Historicon 2019.